Hi, I'm Diana Wong, a product manager on the Android developer team for foldables, tablets, and large screens. We're really excited about the innovations made in foldables and tablets over the last year. Android apps are getting used on larger and larger screens, and users are expecting more from these devices. Let's unfold what's new on large screens. In this talk, we'll explain what app developers should do to prepare their apps for large screens, as well as recent updates we've made to make developing your app easier. But first, let's talk about what we're seeing with large screens and why you should optimize your app. As we look at the evolution of the phone, the three fastest periods of mobile growth have been driven by screen size increases. Users are valuing larger screens and the capabilities of doing more with a single device. The ability to fold a screen is enabling better ergonomics for larger devices. Now you can fit a tablet-sized screen in your pocket, unlocking utility users previously wouldn't be able to get on a device that they could easily carry around. When we're thinking about our app ecosystem, we're excited because this is a huge hardware shift that is driving new expectations around what you can do from a phone. We see this demand for larger screens extending to tablets as well. Since the app experience is similar, we'll be talking about them together. Over the past year, we've seen device makers release exciting new foldable and tablet devices. Demand has increased as users are doing more than ever from these devices while at home. Tablet sales grew 16% in 2020, with analysts expecting more than 400 million Android tablets by 2023. And foldables are redefining what's possible on premium devices, with an estimated 30 million foldable devices in the next 2 years. Android apps can also run on Chrome OS, which has seen a surge of interest and is now the second most popular desktop OS. Altogether, an app today can reach more than 250 million active foldables, tablets, and Chromebooks by building for Android large screen devices. We're excited about this momentum as large screens continue to grow in reach. Now is the time to get your app ready. Our data shows that users love large screen devices. The bigger the screen, the more time users tend to spend on the device, and the deeper their engagement. More than 40% of users on the Samsung Galaxy Z Fold 2 changed their display settings to a resolution greater than 600 dp width, giving them a full tablet experience in their apps and making room for more content. Being able to do more on the screen is one of the top reasons users love these devices, allowing them to increase their productivity both inside and outside the workplace. Larger screens are also changing how users interact with their device. These devices allow you to edit slide decks while looking at notes, look up restaurant recommendations while planning a night out, or watch a video while chatting with friends. We see around a 10x increase of users going into split screen or multi-window mode when they use a foldable versus a typical smartphone. Developers should expect that their app won't be the only one on the screen or the only thing a user can see anymore. For example, use cases like drag and drop now become a more expected user experience. Lastly, foldable devices also bring the ability to place a screen in tabletop mode, a key use case for these devices, perfect for hands-free activities like watching videos or taking calls. Lots of apps are optimizing for large screens, taking advantage of the larger real estate and enabling exciting new experiences. For example, Disney Plus updated their mobile app for devices such as the Samsung Galaxy Z Fold 2 to accommodate folding and unfolding and optimizing the user experience for larger screens. Viewers can take advantage of watching shows on the full larger screen or set the foldable down in tabletop mode for a hands-free experience. We've got new case studies so you can see how these apps have adapted for the larger form factors. Take a look at the link below for more information. But what does it mean to optimize your app for a large screen? Well, there are hero use cases like tabletop mode or advanced drag and drop, but let's talk about base level support. Features an app has to support to be considered large screen ready. There are three main categories of features to support. The first is to ensure that your app is designed for large screens. To make this easier, we've defined specific window size breakpoints and device classes for developers to optimize for. Add tablet layouts for resolutions greater than 600 dpi, and ensure your apps go edge to edge. Developers should also plan for their app to be in portrait and landscape mode, since larger screens are more likely to be used in landscape. We've got material adaptive components that we'll be talking about to help apps make better use of the space. Second is that developers should plan for apps to handle the updated multitasking experiences well by having their apps be resizable, handling folding and unfolding, as well as planning for your app to be in multi-window mode will prevent users from seeing your app in a letterboxed experience. Supporting multi-instance and multi-resume is particularly useful for productivity apps, so users can do more with your app side by side. Lastly, since larger screens are being used more for productivity use cases, basic keyboard, mouse, and stylus support is required for tablet usage. We've talked about how your app should support these devices. Now, over to Ken to talk about how we've made it easier for you to adapt your app.
Thanks, Diana. Let's start with components that will help you build a responsive UX to take your phone UI to unfolded and larger tablet screens. Common patterns such as list detail are an easy way to optimize your current app's experience for these devices. UIs that would normally lay on top of each other have the ability to be placed side by side when you have the space for it. We've updated sliding pane layout in version 1.2.0 to try and do this for you out of the box. Sliding pane layout will use the width of both panes to determine if they can be placed side by side. Let's say if you have a chat list pane that requires 200 dp of width and the actual chat detail requires 400, on any window size greater than 600 dp, those two panes will be placed side by side. We've also added the feature of sliding pane layout being aware of display features such as folds and hinges, and will automatically place your content across them if possible. A good example of this is if somebody is holding a foldable device half open, we will determine if we can place your content on each side of the fold and then do it out of the box. We've also brought the idea of lock modes to give you more control as a developer over the swipe gestures on each screen. An example where this may be useful is if you want your users to only access a message by pressing on it, but you want them to have the ability to swipe back to go back to the list. Sliding pane layout is currently in beta in 1.2.0. Next up, we're going to talk about the new Navigation Rail component. Navigation Rail is a new material component that will help you provide better ergonomics for navigation as your UI scales. Reachability on some of these devices is a major key due to most people holding tablets on the sides versus holding their phone on the bottom. And so Navigation Rail allows you to move your navigation where people can access it. It also allows your content to remain the main focus since the navigation is out of the way. Adding Navigation Rail should be very low impact as both bottom navigation and Navigation Rail support the same set of APIs. Adding Navigation Rail to certain window sizes in your app should be very, very small code changes. Check out the materials session, 5 things you can do today to prepare your app for large screens, for more information. Another thing we've done is add MaxWidth properties across multiple of the material components. One of the major pitfalls that we see in apps on larger screens is UI elements being stretched across the entire screen, as that's how you have it on a phone. On bigger screens, though, this tends to just look very stretched and just gives a bad user experience. You're kind of wasting screen real estate. So we've added MaxWidth properties on some of the elements that we see this happen the most, such as buttons, text fields, and sheets. This brings opinionated values to improve the UX of your app out of the box with no changes for you to make. Beyond components, we have also built the WindowManager Jetpack library to help developers build great and differentiated experiences. WindowManager Jetpack is a library to support new device form factors and provide a common API surface for supporting different and new device types, starting with foldables and tablets. It's currently in alpha and will soon move to beta and stable. WindowManager Jetpack introduces the idea of display features and provides callbacks to be notified if your app is impacted by a display feature, such as a fold or a hinge. A fold is generally a constant screen that bends, such as the Samsung Galaxy Fold 2, whereas a hinge would be a scenario where your app is actually spanned across two screens, such as the Microsoft Surface Duo. Both are encapsulated in our folding feature class. It also gives information about how that feature impacts your app, such as if it's actually separating content, like a device in tabletop mode, or if it's actually occluding content, like could be on a hinge device. Adjusting your UI can be tough, but Constraint Layout 2.1 has a bunch of new features to make this much easier. 2.1 introduces the ideas of shared values and reactive guides, which allow you to inject the position of the fold at runtime. From here, your layout would adjust to the reactive guide, just as it would with a normal guideline. Motion Layout also has updates to allow you to automatically animate to the new fold position, as well as allowing you to easily model these different device states. In this example here, you can see this in action, where the device goes into half-folded mode. The plant list slides in to allow the detail pane to be shown. Let's look at how this would actually look like in code. Here you can see that we're looking at the display feature and the properties of it, and then adjusting the reactive guideline, as well as starting our layout animations. Check out the What's New in Design Tools talk for more constraint layout information. How to reliably develop for foldables is a question that we get a lot, and we want to make sure you can ship these new experiences and have confidence in both their quality and stability. We've rebuilt the APIs provided in Jetpack Window Manager to provide a better testing experience out of the box. We are also working on a testing module for WindowManager Jetpack to better help you write automated tests. Our goal is to introduce test rules, as well as the ability to model device state changes, such as going in and out of tabletop mode, to allow you to make sure that your UI is reacting correctly. We're planning on adding more to the testing story as time goes on, so please let us know what you're looking for. More information can be found in the documentation at the link below. Now, as mentioned earlier, multi-window is used more and more on larger screens, and you can't always assume that your app will be running in full screen. In Android 11, we introduced the Window Metrics APIs to allow you to have the right information you need for your window instead of focusing on display information. In Android 12, we have deprecated the GetRealSize and GetRealMetrics methods on display to go along with the previous deprecations of GetSize and GetMetrics. We've brought the Window Metrics APIs to Jetpack Window Manager to allow you to support older versions of Android with the same APIs, as well as reducing the confusion around previous display APIs. Now, current window metrics will give you the current bounds of your window, while maximum window metrics will give the largest bounds available in the current system configuration. Now, an example of where maximum window metrics will change are scenarios with multiple displays, where the maximum window metrics value will change depending on the display that your app's window is running on. Neither of these APIs should be used for the direct layout of UI elements, but these APIs are designed to be used if you need to make decisions about which layout you want to show or calculations that need to be made for your UI. And maximum can be a good indicator if you have specific parts of your UI that you don't want to change, regardless of the window size. Both of these values are available to you in OnCreate so that you can make these decisions before the first layout pass. Those are some of the updates that we've made. We've also updated developer.android.com to make it easier for you to find the information you need. Check out our new large screen hub with the URL on screen, where you'll find in-depth articles on getting large screen ready, case studies, as well as samples for the things we've talked about today. Here you can find all the resources we've talked about in this session, and we've hoped that you've had fun as we've unfolded the amazing stuff we're working on. Thank you for watching.